हेलो फ्रेंड्स, केजी क्लासेस में आपका स्वागत है। आज हम आपको रॉबर्ट ब्राउनिंग 1812 टू 1889 के लॉन्ग आंसर के बारे में बताएंगे। क्वेश्चन है, डिस्कस ब्राउनिंग एज ए पोएट ऑफ लव। आंसर है, ऑन कंजुगल लव फॉर हिज वाइफ एलिजाबेथन बैरेट रैन ए हैप्पी कोर्स एंड फॉर्म्स वन ऑफ द ग्रेट रोमांसेस इन लिटरेचर। हैप्पी इंटेलेक्ट पैशन एंड एन इक्वल सेंस ऑफ पेरेंटहुड ऑन द पार्ट ऑफ बोथ वेयर द मेजर फैक्टर दैट ब्रॉट अबाउट सच ए परफेक्ट यूनियन ऑफ देयर इंटेंस पर्सनैलिटी दैट इट इज डिफिकल्ट टू थिंक ऑफ द वन विदाउट द अदर। हेडिंग है, ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ एक्चुअल पैशन। इन हिज लव पोएम्स ही डज नॉट ट्रीट ऑफ एब्सोल्यूट लव, लव फॉर लव ऑफ आइडियाज और लव ऑफ वन्स ऑन कंट्री, नॉर इज ही कंटेंट विद मियरली सेलिब्रेटिंग द फिजिकल चार्म्स एंड ड्यूटीज ऑफ और मूड ऑफ द फेयर सेक्स। ही ट्रीट्स ऑफ द एक्चुअल पैशन ही कन्फाइंस हिमसेल्फ टू द लव बिटवीन मैन एंड वीमेन। His poems expresses the insulated a passion of one sex for the other, but the way in which he treats of such love is different from that of Shelley. Browning's love has no individual note about it. It is not merely sensuous, but is intellectual in his own life. He had not experienced romantic love, and as such he analyzes human love as though from a high pedestal. Heading, love a surer way of exalting the soul. Another notable thing about his love poetry is that it is particularly helpful for understanding his philosophy of life. According to him, there is no failure for a man struggling for a novel case. The struggle itself is its own reward. Fulfillment is triumph. It is an elevation of the finite towards the infinite. But for Browning, love is a surer way of exalting the human soul to a higher life, because love breaks all barriers of selfishness and narrow outlook and releases man from the prison walls of his own absorbing self. Love destroys all isolation and helps a person to mingle perfectly with another without losing one's individuality. Adding optimism in love, love in itself is a reward. Another important aspect of his conception of love is its optimism. Just as according to him, effort is its own reward or triumph, so also love in itself is fulfillment. Again, just as to glorify failure is his favorite theme, so is the glorification of the tragedy of unfulfilled love the subject of many of his poems written after his wife's death. The characteristics note in them, however, as in Prospice, is that of love triumphing over death. He recognized only one real tragedy of love, that of false love, which falls and fades away for want of sincerity and courage. Thus, he never had anything to do with purely tragic and hopeless crises. He glorified even unrequited love. Many of his poems are song of fulfillment love. His love poems may be roughly divided into two groups, personal and impersonal. In all his personal poems, By the Fireside, Epilogue to Men and Women, and Prospice, dwell upon the devotional love with which he had for his wife. Some of these impersonal poems are Love Among the Ruins and Two in the Compagna. In these he describes love with the seriousness of one who has left youth behind. He represents not the love of happy youth, but love tossed on the stormy seas of manhood and womanhood. Love is intermingled with graver thoughts of life. Next question is, write a note on Robert Browning as a poet. Heading introduction. Robert Browning is one of the two great poets of the Victorian age. The other is Tennyson. He is regarded as one of the most remarkable poets in English poetry. He has many outstanding characteristics in his poetry, and his characteristics have made him an immortal poet. He shows a great skill in dramatic monologue. It is said about him that he is the most successful poet of dramatic monologue. In his poetic works, he observes a certain philosophy of life and death. This philosophy put him in the line of the great philosopher. He is also one of the greatest love poets, and many of his love poems are unique works in English poetry. These characteristics of his poetry reveal the fact that he is a highly original poet in English poetry. Heading his philosophy. Browning's poetry has a certain philosophy about life, death, and God. In his poetry, he presents a certain theory of the relationship between man and universe. He is a cheerful optimist, and his optimism gives the message of morality. He believes that God is in his heaven and all is right with the world. In fact, the poet believes that man must have faith in struggle, not in achievement. He thinks that the struggle between good and evil is necessary for human life. After death of the body, the real life of the soul starts. So this life is a preparation for the life to come. His philosophical thought becomes very important for him when he shows his firm faith in God. He never questions about the existence of God. In fact, his message is always the message of humanity. Long points out his energy, his cheerful courage, and his faith in life are like a bugle to good living. Heading as a poet of love. Chesterton calls Browning the greatest of love poets and his poetry the finest love poetry in the world. In his love poetry, Browning deals with the physical love and the spiritual love. His love poems can be divided into two parts, personal love poems and impersonal love poems. In his personal love poems, he expresses his own experiences about love. His famous poems One World More and By the Fireside are his personal love poems. In his impersonal love poems, he presents the experience of others. Meeting at Night and Porphyria's Lover are his impersonal love poems. Heading the poet of dramatic monologue. Robert Browning produced many famous dramatic monologues in a successful manner. He is so much successful in the presentation of the dramatic monologue that no poet can be compared with him. Some of his dramatic monologues, like My Last Duchess, The Last Ride Together, are really models in English poetry. About his wonderful success in dramatic monologue, a famous critic, Hugh Walker, point out, Browning did not invent the dramatic monologue, but he made it especially his own, and no one else has ever put such rich and varied material into it. Heading as a poet of man and nature, Browning's poetry presents many wonderful qualities as a poet of man and nature. In his poetry, he tries to understand human character. He does not ignore the evil of human nature like Shakespeare. He presents his subtle insight into human character. His treatment of nature is original and very outstanding. Like Wordsworth, he also believes that nature is the agent of God, but he does not find any supernatural power in nature. He describes only the natural aspect in his poetry. Obscurity. Browning's poetry has been criticized on the ground of obscurity. Some of his poems are really obscure poems. There are certain regions of his obscurity. In fact, he was very high kind of philosophy. Secondly, he was a very learned poet. Thirdly, he uses allusions and he does not follow the rules of grammar. That is why his poems have the element of obscurity, but some of his poems, like My Last Duchess, Porphyria's Lover, and Meeting at Night, are perfectly free from obscurity. Last heading, conclusion. Browning's enjoy very high reputation in English poetry. He comes in the line of philosophers because he shows his certain philosophy of life, love, death, and God in his poetry. His poetic style is of great importance because he uses very simple, polished, and practical words. He does not intend to make his poetry difficult. His place in English poetry is really very remarkable. A famous critic, Chesterton, points out, Browning belongs to those distinguished poets who are respected as a perfect poets. Short answer type question. Question first, write a short note on Robert Browning as a obscure poet. Answer. Robert Browning has been taken as an obscure poet in English poetry. Some of his poems are too difficult and obscure to understand. He has become an obscure poet because of certain reasons. First of all, he is a highly learned poet. Secondly, he does not pay attention to the rules of grammar. Thirdly, his thoughts are highly philosophical and psychological. That is why some of his poems have become difficult and obscure. Question second, what is the difference between Browning and Tennyson? Answer. Robert Browning and Tennyson are regarded as the greatest poet of Victorian age. Though both Browning and Tennyson got supreme place, sometimes Browning is placed higher than Tennyson. Tennyson was purely a Victorian poet and he wrote for the people of Victorian age. That is why in the poetry of Tennyson, patriotism can be well noted. On the other hand, Browning presents universal ideas. Browning deals with optimistic ideas and Tennyson does not present such type of optimism. Tennyson is a great master of musical language, while Browning cannot produce musical language. Question 3. Write a short note on the art of characterization found in the poetry of Browning. Answer. Browning is certainly a great master of characterization. He understands human nature well and his psychology of mankind is very sharp. In his remarkable poems, he has produced different types of character. He started his career as a dramatist only because he was a great master of characterization. Many of his characters have become immortal because they are vivid and life skill. Objective type question. Question. Browning was born in, answer, 1812. Question. Ravi Ben Ezra by Browning is, answer, a dramatic monologue. Question. Browning's poem Prospice show poet's intention about, answer, awareness of death. Question. Robert Browning especially wrote on, answer, optimism. Question. Which of the following works is not by Browning? Answer. Orlando. Question. Browning was a poet of, answer, optimist. Question. Which of the following poems is not by Browning? Answer. Behind the Bell. Question. Browning died in, answer, 1889. Question. In which poem does it occur? I was ever a fighter, so one fight more. Answer. Prospice. Question. Who said this? I was ever a fighter, so one fight more, the best and the last. Answer. Browning. Select literary opinions on Browning's poetry. First, Thomas Hood's apprenticeship to the music hall, his writing of sketch and songs to be presented by the popular comedian Charles Matthew, vastly extended the vocabulary, the meter, and the elusiveness of 19th century poetry. This new capital of which Hood himself lived to make very little use was taken over by Browning for such a poem as Pied Piers and finally developed into a medium capable of expressing far greater psychological accuracy, of referring to far more things in a far less poetical way than any other Victorian poet could achieve. Anyone comparing the nimble arguments of the Ring and the Book with the conventional narrative flow, the idealist of the King, will realize the point of his argument, which I shall develop at length in later chapters. Browning took over from Hood and incidentally passed on to Ezra Pound, and so to our day rhythms halfway between the spoken and the dramatic, between Charles Mathew and Shakespeare's J.M. Cohen, Robert Browning ke anusar. Second, I cannot at this moment think of any poet, dramatist or novelist who has invented so many plots as Browning. He seems to present to us a few leading ideas in a vast series of incarnations. Over and over again, the same thoughts, the same doctrines are repeated, but the scenery, the situation and the characters are never alike. Here is where he remains true to the theory set forth in Transcendentalism. The poet should not produce thoughts but rather concrete image of them, or as he says in closing lines of The King and the Book, art must do the thing that breeds the thought. William Leon Phelps Browning cancer. Shakespeare is not our poet, but the world's, therefore on him no speech and brief for fee. Browning, since Chaucer was alive and hail, no man hath walked along our roads with step so active, so conquering eye or tongues, so varied in disgrace. A Walter Savage Lander Alien Dior Lander Kensar. Third, the study of no individual character would seem to him of capital value unless that character contains something which should help to throw light upon matters common to all humanity, upon the inquiries either as to what it or as to what are its relation to the things outside humanity. This is not quite the highest form of dramatic poetry. There is in it perhaps something of the error of seeking too quick returns of profit and of drawing a circle premature, to use Browning's own words, heedless of far again the fault, if it be one, lay partly in Browning's epoch, partly in the nature of his genius. Such a method of deflected dramatic characterization as his is less appropriate to regular drama than to the monologue, and accordingly the monologue, reflective or lyrical, became the most characteristic instrument of his art. Edward Dowden, Robert Browning cancer. Fourth, 2 points man's way than not to justify God seems to me Browning's business. Would he but have minded it here? Indeed, he provides another interesting contrast with Tennyson. For in Tennyson's, as we have seen, the human figures matter less than the landscape. The moated grange moves us more than Marina herself. Many fountained Ida than on one's tears. What in Browning's, the exact reverse is true. The world of nature matter less to him than human beings. It forms only the background of his portraits. Indeed, it often becomes itself half humanized. F. L. Locus, 8 Victorian poet cancer. Fifth, in my youth, he says, is in one of his letter, I wrote only musically and after stopped all that so effectually that I now catch myself grudging my woman their half pound like a Paris overseer the deed doll of his charge. But why, there is a certain pause about that. So Plato said, he saw the pride of antist alertness, the cynic peeping through the holes in his rage. It is indeed as if the course of Browning's Paracelsus is a similar mixture of true poet and charlatan had fallen on Browning himself. I cannot feed on beauty for the sake of beauty only, nor can drink and balm from lovely objects for their loveliness. I still must hoard and heap and class alter truth will one ulterior purpose I must now. F. L. Lucas, 8 Victorian poet ke anusar. 6. But while Browning's energetic temperament habitually impelled him to present character in action, his imaginative strength did not lie in that region of action at all, but in the region of thought. The kinds of expression of which he had boundless command were rather those which analyze character than those which exhibit it. Two impulses derived from temperament and from imagination drew him in somewhat reverse direction, and for some years the joy in the stir and stress and many-sided life of drama competed with powerful bent of the portrayer of souls, until the two contending currents finally coalesced in the dramatic monologue of Men and Women. C. H. Harford, Robert Browning cancer. Thanks, best of luck.